by 45.
45 to the show.
Be the first tape. Hey, Cal, we'll be coming to you.
Three, two, one.
With a car.
We're on the air.
Birth of a nation, the end of a British colonial era. As our beloved nation took this giant step of independence, Trinidad and Tobago television held up the mirror, reflecting our brand new start. Our nation's first birthday, the station's first live broadcast. Two defining moments celebrated as one.
I think it meant for some people that we had entered the world as a country, because we had this new plaything, television.
We were young, we were vibrant, we were fresh, we were new. And so what TTT was an opportunity for the nation to be informed, entertained, right, and educated.
It represented ambition. It represented the quest to be among the nations of the world with television coverage.
The government set up television stations in like Woodford Square and a few other squares, but people didn't have sets at that time.
The set count was only 1,500 television sets. The population at that time might have just been around 800,000 in Trinidad and Tobago.
In fact, TTT did not exist as a building at that time. It was just a concrete slab. From what I understand from reading, they built a quick hut on the slab with enough room for Mervyn Telfer, who was the first presenter on television.
The new national station provided our young nation with an early collection of local celebrities.
The TTT story is a big story. It's a long story. It's populated by huge personalities.
People like Trevor MacDonald, Clyde Elaine, Mervyn Telfer, who was the very first news anchor at TTT.
Even Peter Minshall, later on, was a news presenter.
Don Proudfoot, Bobby Thomas.
Alison Hennessy, Albert Charles, Wellington Yenchong, Jamaluddin Samad, and the list goes on. All names of persons who were in various roles and capacities at TTT.
I love Mr. Raffy Knowles.
You probably don't know the name, but Raffy Knowles was a legendary sports presenter on Panorama. He would memorize the whole sports broadcast. He was also meticulous with his statistics, and he would learn all those statistics and he would just spout them out.
The eyes and ears of a nation giving us a glimpse into some of the earliest viral worthy moments.
Blue Boy going on, and the whole stage is full of people.
Everybody,
there's Shadow singing Pak Pak, but the crowd is just losing its mind. I'm so glad that we had a television station there to capture those things.
A lot could be said about TTT as an institution.
I born 2 years after independence, so we're the first independent generation. I'm watching TTT back in the day as the only station that was your conduit to the world.
Trinidad and Tobago Television was created by Canadian businessman Roy Thompson, then owner of the Thompson Organization. Back then, a partnership existed between the Thompson Organization, Rediffusion, a business that distributed radio and TV signals, CBS, and the government of Trinidad and Tobago, who then owned a 10% share in the television station. Channels 2 and 13 were the two channels used to transmit the service. The initial operational management was a combination of foreign and local individuals. The success of any nation depends on the collective efforts of its people. Much like their newly independent country, the new employees of TTT would roll up their sleeves, committed and dedicated to this unknown territory despite their color, creed and race.
The training I received was very hands-on.
Salaries started at $375 a month for a trainee. You know, $375 went a long way when you're living by your mother and you don't really have any expenses.
The experienced editors trained me. So I sat and I looked at them and I watched what they were doing. And then you go in and you try to get your hands dirty. As an editor, what we did was we had to make sure that there was no obscene content. We had to hold the film and clean the film as it goes through the reels and clean the film to make sure there were no holes in the film and there were no slices.
When I left high school, I walked into TTT at 17 and said I want a job because I had seen an after-school program where people were actually on the TV looking like me. And they're like, we don't hire minors, so come back when you're 18. So I went away and I came back when I was 18 and said, okay, I'm 18, I want a job. And they made me wait for like 3 months, but that's a whole other story. I would start as a trainee reporter in the newsroom. I never wanted to be a reporter. I mean, it used to be, felt good to be talking to my English literature teacher who told me, you know, I was like a crazy person, basically. So I used to be like, I'm telling you the news, you have to listen to me. I found it to be a place where I had opportunities and I took them.
Seeing your name rolling in a credit in a show was still something that made you feel proud that you worked on this, especially if you're proud of the show. I mean, there were some shows I told them I don't want a credit, you know what I mean?
We had pride in what we were doing back then.
But and we also had great, you know, camaraderie in terms of liming together.
The station's early programming was a reflection of its ownership, consisting of mainly British and American culture.
You had shows like Bonanza, of course, Bonanza was one of the big shows.
It was an outing for us to go to the neighbor's house to look at Bonanza on a Friday evening. One villager had a TV set.
We would rent our television set in those days. You didn't buy one in the early days, you rented it from Sports and Games, they had tele-rentals. You'd rent it per month, just like you would rent your Ready Fusion set and so on.
There was a shop in the village, a Chinese shop, where we collected our mail. And I went to the shop, and the shopkeeper said to me, there is a letter here for you. And I saw the picture of the four-star cast, Adam, Ben, Hoss, and Little Joe, and I began to shout and show everybody in the shop. I got a personal autographed photograph from the Bonanza crew.
The Lucille Ball show, I Love Lucy, Hogan's Heroes, those are some of the really big shows in those days.
You think he's satisfied? Much as?
We grew up on those monumental films. And there's a story that I can tell related to me by one of the seniors at TTT by the name of Errol Harry Lal, a caller to the station, a female caller to the station in the early life of TTT, called for Little Joe to speak with Little Joe. And Errol, the witty person he was, said to the lady, hold on, ma'am, let me check. And he walked around and came back, took up the phone and said to her, I'm sorry, he just rode off.
I watched enough Indian movie on TTT, so that by the time I got to India, which is one of the high points of my life, going to all those cities in India, went on a trip to India, it was like, you understand the place, it making sense, you know?
You know, we used to run them on a Sunday. They were like 4 or 5 hours long, and we had to go through those tapes and clean them, actually, because they would come in reels, and we had to make sure that the reels didn't have holes so they wouldn't skip when they're being shown. We actually enjoy looking at them because they had this storyline. They will grip you and pull you in.
I remember falling in love with Amitabh Bachchan as a child. Listening to Lata Mangeshkar later on in life because of this cultural grounding of looking at Bollywood films.
I mean, you have to give thanks for that cultural richness. You know, we're not operating in ignorance. It's like, wow, I know this, I'm familiar with this.
Sunny day, sweeping up clouds away, on my way to where the air is safe.
Well, of course, all of us at that age was Sesame Street and Electric Company eventually.
Up to today, I can still sing so many songs from Sesame Street because that was something that we watched with a sort of, you know, religious obsessiveness.
And do the duck, rubber duck, duck, rubber duck, rubber duck, duck, rubber duck, duck, rubber duck, duck, rubber duck, duck, rubber duck.
But the station's first programming manager, Farooq Mohammed, had his eyes set on doing something more.
I always saw Trinidad and Tobago as a multicultural, a poly nation with many cultures. And so I tried to reflect on the screen faces from all of the various ethnic groups in Trinidad and Tobago. So there was a combination of cultural programming and sport.
Best Village, Indian Cultural Magazine, No Boundaries, Community Dateline, That Week with Yusuf Ali, Not for Women Only, College Quiz, Calypso Showcase, News Capsule, Play Your Cards Right, the first game show in the country, Teen Dance Party, Ricky Tikki, Parade, Indian Variety, Mastana Bahar, Scouting for Talent, 12 and Under, Teen Talent, Party Time, Talking It Out. That's just some of the content.
I mean, those things, you know, kind of make you feel real in the society that you live in. And the things that I do, they're not totally invisible and they're not totally things that are hidden and denied from the national conversation about what it means to be Trinidadian or Tobagonian.
Because it isn't necessarily a black face, an Indian face, an Asian face. It's just someone who I could identify with across all lines. Who owns the story for me is even as important as who tells the story. And so for many years, you had our stories being told by other people who had a different impression of who we are. And so we grew up thinking, this is beauty. This is what's important. These are the persons I need to emulate. This is my impression of what the world looks like. And it may not be our world.
Our very first Prime Minister, Dr. Eric Williams, in one of his initial speeches said that, you know, the future way forward for the people of the Caribbean is to be the subjects of their story and not the objects, so not being defined by others. We have to take on the task of defining ourselves, to ourselves, for ourselves. I was like a kind of a TV guide in the house. Like, I knew what shows were coming up on what day and whatnot. I was inherently a TV peon. I was drawn to TV. I was intrigued by TV. I would watch almost anything that was on the TV at the time. I remember one of the main things I got from early television was Best Village, a sense of our folk culture. Scouting was huge. Watching the many characters that come up, and some of them surprise you and some of them are just so funny.
All sorts of people would be on it. We were very disparaging. We used to call it scrunting for talent. You know, there was a deep, deep value to being able to see yourself replicated on a show like this.
Interestingly enough, German, Auntie German, Erishi, ran the show at the time. And so, you know, she would say, you have to come on the show, you guys have to come. And I would come as a six-year-old, read my poem, you know, pretty birds in the trees, sing for me, please. When you sing, you bring me joy like my beautiful toy. I wrote that when I was 6 years old and I came and I recited it. So, you know, I was like a regular coming on and off. And then when I was 13 years of age, and then, you know, I'd come and do little things like make my cookies or whatever, right? But then when I was 13 years of age, O'Neill Davis, I was waiting on my brother who was doing the Rikki Tikki Disco Time at the time, Robert Wickham. So I was waiting on Robert and O'Neill said, Lisa, come, I have something for you to do. I was 13 and I said, no, not me, not me. And then he said, yes, come. And he put me to do the spelling bee, right? And that was the segment where, you know, I'd ask, spell Robert, you know, or spell whatever. And it was a full segment. So I did it because, you know, your girl have to shine wherever you go. And he said, at the end, he said, well, you know, this is not going to be the last time you do this. And that's how I got that segment, right? So it was the Rikki Tikki Spelling Bee. And then, you know, just continued doing weekly, every week. And to date, I think it's still the only live children's show that ever existed. That prepared me for so much because it prepared me for being able to be spontaneous, confident, because live is live, right? And live is a different animal. So I always liked live since then. And then just staying on, so I did that all the way up until sixth form. And then Albert Charles called me. He said, I've spoken to Wendell. I think Wendell was casted first, Constantine, right? He said, you're the person who he wanted, you know, as his female lead. And I said, okay, for what? He said, well, party time. I was like, what? And that, let me tell you, that was like nothing we've ever experienced before, because that, again, one TV station, no internet. I know people watching this are like, no internet? What's going on? You know, but no internet, nothing else but TTT. So can you imagine the whole country watching Party Time? That was insane. Welcome back.
Welcome back. You grew up in the 80s where, you know, you're seeing like this kind of TV that is almost nostalgic, right? And that belongs to your parents. And then Party Time happens and all of a sudden you're seeing your contemporaries. You know, like I remember the first time, you know, seeing, what was the name of that group that Hot Dog was in? But, you know, then they came into schools and it was like, these are our stars. You know, so Hot Dog being on the street, Marlon Grant is his name, but, you know, seeing Hot Dog on the street, seeing people like Jamie Thomas, the late Jamie Thomas.
Party Time provided the platform for young people to show their talent.
Marshall Montano and the Pranasonic Express debuted on Party Time. Oscar Benjamin won the lip-sync category of Party Time and was selected by Byron Lee to be his frontline vocalist from Jamaica Carnival for 10 years onwards. We've had Sinead Dempster. We've had Denise Belfour. We have persons from H2O Flow, persons who went on to record with the Kiskadee Caravan. Some became dancers for outstanding groups, both locally and internationally.
Ricardo Mendoza, who is now a big singer in New York. You know, Ozzy Merrick, who won lip syncing with a David Rudder song, which was unheard of in that time.